The title of the talk is Economic Freedom and the Health and Wealth of Nations, which of course is a play on Adam Smith's title of his book, but really it's about the economic freedom of the world. And I'm going to speak about the report that was just released a few weeks ago by the Fraser Institute in Canada, which is the publisher of our product. But before I really talk about numbers and so on, I want to frame the reason why we started doing this project. And I'm going to talk about these two gentlemen here, Adam Smith on the one hand and Karl Marx on the other. Yeah, we could certainly substitute other intellectual thinkers. We could talk about Mises or Hayek or Milton Friedman on the one hand, or we could talk about other left intellectuals on the other hand, but I'm going to use these two gentlemen as sort of the iconic figures that really have framed the debate that we've had for the last couple hundred years. So first, Smith. Adam Smith wrote the great book, The Inquiry into the Nature and Causes of the Wealth of Nations, 1776. It's a very long book, and the short version of it is freedom works. Well, he didn't call it economic freedom. He didn't call it capitalism. He didn't even call it laissez-faire. His term of art was a system of natural liberty, which is a term that I'd like to bring back to the language. It's a sort of sings, a system of natural liberty. And he said a system of natural liberty, which meant a lot of things, free trade, private property, the kinds of things that Peter, in fact, talked a lot about in the very first talk. Adam Smith basically says that system works pretty good. He emphasized one particular aspect a lot, and that was trade. He had the audacity to argue that the people of England would be better off if they freely traded with the people of France, which was an argument that was difficult to make in 18th century England or Scotland. After all, England and France had been having wars on and off again with each other for hundreds of years, and they hated each other, and now they don't so much, I suppose, but at least off the soccer field. So this was Smith. Freedom works. Okay. A few generations later, Karl Marx comes along, and he says, you know, these economists, these Smithian-type economists, he called them the classical economists, they're wrong. Freedom doesn't work. Capitalism, that was Marx's term of art for this thing we're talking about. Capitalism doesn't work. And the long list of complaints that Marx and Marxists have about capitalism is a very long list. We don't teach, at least at my university, we don't teach a lot of Marxian economics anymore. But you all probably know, have a vague sense of what the list is. What's the complaints? Well, monopoly, natural monopoly is, you know, capitalism gives us monopolies. Capitalism gives us exploitation of the poor, poverty, business cycles, financial crises. In fact, according to Karl Marx, this system of capitalism is going to be so horrific for so many people that eventually they're going to violently overthrow the system. So we have these two people. One guy says freedom works. Hey, land, it's not the land of milk and honey. I guess I have to say, can I say that here? All right. It's not going to be like utopia on earth, but Adam Smith said, you know, this system of natural liberty will deliver the goods. The wealth of the nation will be higher, we'll be happier, live longer, whatever. And Marx says, no, it's going to be so horrible, people are going to actually violently overthrow it. Now, one of these guys is wrong. Well, maybe they're both wrong, but at least one of them is wrong. They're saying opposite things about the world you and I live in. Now, most of the debate that's gone on between these two people, most of the debate that I used to, when I was your age, when I was in college, I went to a school called Ohio University. It's known in the United States anyway for being a bit of a left-wing university. Most of my friends were socialists or communists. I mean communists with a capital C. I mean, I remember college classmates of mine. I remember professors of mine wearing red armbands marching through campus on May Day. So when I say they were communists, this is not just some flippant remark. They were actually communists, you know. So the debates that I remember having with my college friends, I was not a communist. I was the young Republican and, you know, very straight. The arguments were very heated. They were a lot like these two people down here. I would say something like, you know, this is 1980, so, you know, we should privatize some more industries. And they used to say, no, we need to nationalize the industries. We should cut taxes. No, we should raise taxes. We should have freer trade. No, we need to protect people from the vicissitudes of international trade. It was a lot of is and is nots. We should do this. No, we shouldn't. And of course, Ohio University, by the way, is the number one party school, according to Playboy magazine. So frequently while we were having these debates, there was alcohol involved. And as the evening wore on and the debates got they got more heated, we would start name calling. I would, you know, you're a commie pinko. And they would call me, you're a dirty capitalist pig. You know, the name calling would eventually erupt. Now, at the end of my years at Ohio University, I can claim exactly zero converts to my worldview. And not a single one of my friends that I argued with for all those years convinced me that they were right. We were arguing with each other night after night, week after week, beer pitcher after beer pitcher. And at the end of the day, we just yelled at each other. No, we didn't really reach an agreement. We didn't sit down. You know, what do they, if you ever have like debate, what do they tell you about? Well, let's sit down and debate the topics, right? And we'll reach truth. You'll say what you think is true. I'll say what I, eventually we'll, no, that's not what happened. We just yelled at each other for 4 years. All right. Now I'd like you to, and that's how debates in economics all too often go down. A lot of people with a lot of heat yelling at each other. Not a lot of light being generated by that heat, okay? I'd like to contrast that with what happens in the natural sciences. Now, like a lot of economists, I'm a frustrated physicist. If I was a little bit smarter, I would have gone into physics. But I'm not that smart, so I went into economics, okay? But I still have physics envy a little bit. And I actually, in my spare time, I love studying physics for fun, which is weird, but there you have it. Now, in the natural sciences, there are debates, and those debates can be, in fact, frequently very heated. One of the great early 20th century debates was whether or not Einstein's theory of special relativity was correct, because it actually is a little bit different than Newton's theory of gravity. The theory of gravity and special relativity is different. They're not that different. In fact, for most purposes, Newton's equations work just fine. They keep the bridges from falling down. The skyscrapers stand up straight. You know, the world works pretty good if we use Newton's equations. But if you're trying to shoot a missile or a probe to Pluto and you use Newton's equations, you're going to miss Pluto. It turns out they're a little bit wrong. And we debated this in the early 20th century. And how did they settle the debate? We now know Einstein's special relativity is correct. Newton's theory of gravity is wrong. How do we know that? We measured where the moon is. We measured really carefully where the moon is, or where the sun is. And we said, you know, if Einstein's equations are right, the moon's going to be right there. And if Newton's equations are right, the moon's going to be a little bit off. And every time we did those measurements very carefully, Einstein was right. So now we're pretty sure Einstein's equations are right. By the way, Einstein's like batting 1,000, as we say in America. He's 100%. There's like nothing in special relativity we've yet been able to find doesn't work. Okay. So we now know something. Were there arguments in physics about this? Yes. Did people stake their careers on the wrong side and lose those? Yes. But at the end of the day, we learned which of those two theories of how the physical world works, universe works, we learn by measuring very carefully and evaluating which of the two theories was more consistent with our evidence. I would like to suggest to you, with all due respect, we are different than the natural sciences. Economics is deeply and fundamentally different than natural sciences, but I would like to suggest to you that we should act more like the natural sciences and less like these two people screaming at each other. Okay. And that brings me to the project called the Economic Freedom of the World Project. My job is to try to put a number to measure how economically free a country is, how close to Adam Smith's view of the world a country is. The country is the unit of analysis here. And I think this group, especially with Peter's excellent introductory lecture, I think this group sort of has a pretty good sense of what I mean when I say economic freedom. It's a system based on private property, individuals making choices about their economic lives, about where they work, what jobs they take, which products they buy, from whom they buy those products, and so on. The decision making about economic life is left to the individual as opposed to the collective, as opposed to, say, the government, which is the most practical representation of the collective. So that's what economic freedom is. I'm going to put a number on. Now, that sounds very hard to do. How do you put a number on economic freedom? It's kind of fuzzy, you know, freedom, right? Well, we put numbers on things that are hard to measure all the time. We've mentioned GDP already a couple times today. GDP is the dollar value of all the new final goods and services produced in the country in a year. Well, that's a really fuzzy concept too, actually. And right after I teach GDP to my students, what do we do? Here's the definition of GDP, and then the rest of the class is all the things GDP does wrong. right? Oh, we count this, but really we shouldn't count that. And we don't count this, really we should count that. We had that, a little bit of that, like we had the leisure debate earlier, right? We, you know, should we or shouldn't we count? Leisure is not counted in GDP. Leisure is a pretty good thing. I like leisure time. More leisure is better than less leisure. Yeah, we don't. If we all get more leisure, we don't include that in GDP. And arguably, GDP goes down when I take a day off, right? Which is kind of bizarre, really. We don't count that good in GDP. So GDP is a measure of the size of the economy, but it's not a perfect measure. It's a measure that makes mistakes, and we know about those mistakes. In America, we have a big debate about who the college football champion is every year. A huge debate about that, but we do it anyway. We put rankings. You're number one, you're number two, you're number three. If it's a good year, it's Florida State's number one, and then everybody else is below that. But we put numbers on things all the time that are fuzzy, hard to measure. Someone mentioned the happiness indexes. I mean, if there was something that's fuzzy to measure, how happy you are. I'm actually feeling pretty good. After lunch, I'm a lot happier than I am right before lunch. So I'm feeling like I'm a 7.2 right now. And before lunch, I was like a 5.1. So anyway, I'm a firm believer that if you care about something enough, you should care about that thing enough to try to measure it, try to be more refined about it. And that sometimes means putting some arbitrary numbers on things. In terms of the practical index, it is a data-driven index. Now, I'm a product of the public schools in the United States, which is to say I could not place most countries on a map if you made me. So when I started doing this project, and my professor Jim Gortney came to me and says, Lawson, we're going to do an economic freedom index for 120 countries. I'm like, there are 120 countries? Really? And where are they? And I think I was 23 years old before I ever heard my first foreign language, right? I mean, this is how parochial and insular American Midwesterners are. So immediately I said, Jim's from Kansas. It's even worse than where I'm from, Ohio. I said, Jim, there's no way that two American economists who just got their first passport a week ago and don't know where Israel is or Congo is or anything on the map, there's no way we're going to do an economic freedom index for all these countries on our own. We got to get data. And we got to get data from people who actually know something about these countries. Who knows something about the country? About, well, the IMF, that's a big group. The World Bank, that's a big group. The World Economic Forum, PricewaterhouseCoopers, a big consulting firm. These are groups that actually engage in business and doing policy all around the world. Let's use their data. Let's go see what they got. And if they've got data that we think measures some aspect or another of economic freedom, let's use their numbers. So the data, the index is entirely data-driven. I do not sit in my office sort of doing, I think Israel's a little higher this year, a little lower this year. I just pull in numbers from the world that are produced by other people. This is also a nice thing. If someone doesn't like any of the numbers, what do I say? Oh, yeah, well, don't blame me. I'm just the messenger. If you don't like that number, I got it from the World Bank. Call them. Go complain to them. So it actually turns out to be a nice defense mechanism when people don't like our results. But it's a data-driven index. Now, there's 42 variables in the index, and we have 157 countries in the most recent version. So I'm going to spare you all that. The book, I actually brought one copy of the book. Bob, I'll leave it for you if you want. But it's the most boring book ever written. It pretty much looks like this. As you can see, it's not very exciting. So 42 variables. But what we do is we collect these 42 variables into five areas. So let me just briefly remark on the five areas of the index. And each of these areas carries a 20% weight. It's a very low tech. We use a very high tech method called taking an average to do this. So the first area is size of government. So I sort of think in my head, this is sort of what would Adam Smith do index. Okay, American Christians for a few years ago, there was a fad. They had these little bracelets that said WWJD. It was what would Jesus do? And it was like a fad for a couple of years, and all these Christian kids were wearing it. Now, I want to get bracelets that say, you know, what would Adam Smith do? WWASD. So what would Adam Smith do? All right. Well, what about the size and role of government? Adam Smith has a chapter in The Wealth of Nations where he talks about the size and role of government. Let me summarize it briefly. The government, according to Adam Smith, should have cops on the street to protect, you know, like to stop the bar fighting. He was Scottish, so, you know, bar fighting is a real problem. So stop the bar fights. Okay, yeah, that's good. You know, keep people from knifing each other. That's a real thing, right? Yeah, right. I actually, they came out and about halfway through the sentence, I'm like, oh, crap, I shouldn't have said that. Sorry. courts. So that someone steals somebody's cow, we can, instead of fighting over it, we go to the judge and say, "Judge, I think that's my cow." And he goes, "No, that's my cow." We'll let a judge figure out whose cow belongs to who, rather than fighting over it and starting wars, you know, clan wars in Scotland, right? So having courts to stop, to sort of keep the basic peace, having courts to settle contract disputes, that's a role of government, according to Adam Smith. He goes on in that chapter, he says, well, maybe we should have some roads and bridges. Those are, he actually was an early, he had an early understanding of what we now today call public goods. And he says, you know, roads and bridges, although he was Adam Smith, you know, capitalist guy, he says, we should have, they should be toll roads and toll bridges, but the government should do that, that's fine. And then he goes on, he says, well, maybe some schools, although he's very critical of government-run schools. He had a horrible experience himself at Oxford. So he had a lot of negative things about schools, but he went on and said, okay, some schools. And then the chapter's over. Courts, cops, roads, bridges, schools. Well, wait. My city, the city of Dallas, free market America, right? We own a hotel, right? That wasn't an Adam Smith chapter, right? Daycare centers, right? Kindergarten, right? Old age pensions, none of that stuff's in Adam Smith's chapter. Adam Smith was a small government guy. Right? He makes American libertarians look like big government people, frankly, a lot of times. He was a small government guy. That's what he was. Now, maybe that's a bad idea, but Adam Smith, that was what he thought, that's what he meant by system of natural liberty, a small government. Now, going on, the second area of the index is an area we generally call legal structure property rights. It's an area that's very hard for us to measure. You can imagine, how do you measure property rights, security of property rights? It's a very fuzzy area. It's the fuzziest of all the areas that we have. We actually have 9 variables from 3 different sources. The most prominent source there is the World Economic Forum's. They have an executive opinion survey. They ask business people who do business all around the world. Across the world, it's thousands and thousands of people that they ask. And they ask them a battery of questions about doing business in that country. Most of the questions are not interesting to me. Like, how easy is it to get an internet hookup? I mean, if you're running a business, that's an important question. I don't really think of that as being an economic freedom issue. But they also ask him things like, how secure are the property rights in the country? How impartial are the judges? How independent are the courts from the political process? How bad is the crime? Right? Because criminals actually infringe on economic freedom, too. So we used some of these survey questions of, asked of business people. For the record, they're actually not just big businesses. They actually ask a range of small, medium-sized enterprises, big enterprises. They ask both domestic and foreign-operated firms. They do their best to make it a pretty good cross-section of business people. And they ask them questions about the property rights and rule of law environment. There is another set of variables, 2 variables from the World Bank there from the Doing Business Project. One of them that I like a lot is the how many days it takes to settle a contract dispute. So if Peter and I live in the same city, so if Peter, if I go to Peter and say, hey, I'd like you to wash my car, and I'll give you $5, but because he's a flake, he just takes my $5 and goes to the bar with my money and doesn't wash my car. You know, he's a criminal, he's a thief. I mean, he's functionally the equivalent of a thief. There's no real difference between a guy who welches out on a $5 contract and a mugger who takes $5 from you, a criminal. So I want to take Peter to court. I mean, actually, being Texas, I get my gun and I just go get my $5 back. But let's do it the right way. I take Peter to court. So the question is, in the United States, how long would it take the United States court system to make him give me my money back? And according to the World Bank, it's about a year. They say it'd take about a year to settle a simple contract dispute, adjudicate it through the legal process in the United States. Well, I mean, we're talking about a very simple, open and shut contract case, so it's sort of no, not including appeals. But the way they set up that, the way the World Bank does that study, is they say there's really no disagreement about who should win this case. The question is just how long is it going to take it to actually happen. That gives you an idea of the kinds of things in the index. The third area is sound money. You know, another type of thief out there is the Federal Reserve or the central bank. You know, when I was 16 years old, my dad, in the United States, you can drive at 16. So I got my driver's license, and my dad, he said, what you need to do, son, very serious for him, because you know, he said, you need to get a $100 bill, which was a lot of money in 1985 or 4 when I was turned 16. You get a $100 bill, and you need to fold it up very tightly and hide it in some recessed part of your wallet. I don't know what he thought I was going to be getting into out there in the world, driving around the mean streets of Cincinnati, Ohio. I don't know if he thought this is my bail money or bribe a cop to get out of a ticket. I don't know what he thought, but he said, you should just do this. And so I did it dutifully. And I do remember that, you know, a year later or so, you're cleaning out your wallet for whatever reason. You find, it's a great day, right? When you find that money, you're like, wow, what's the problem though when I take that $100 bill to the store a year later? It doesn't buy as much a year later as it bought the day I put it in the wallet. If there's been 5% inflation this year, it's like someone took $5 out of my wallet. Now, it's still a $100 bill. Physically, it's a $100 bill. But the purchasing power of that $100 bill has gone down by 5%. Monetary economists like Larry, they call this the inflation tax. Any kind of asset that you have that's denominated in nominal terms, like currency, obviously. But it could be an insurance policy, a mortgage contract, any number of other bonds. A lot of assets that are denominated in nominal terms, they're subject to an arbitrary sort of tax when inflation occurs. So we've got measures in here of inflation. We also have measures in here of whether you're allowed to use other countries' currencies. Larry made a mention of that. Many countries will prohibit you, especially in the past, prohibit you from holding currencies that weren't your own domestic currency. So obviously, if you're a Venezuelan citizen today, you really don't want to hold a lot of Venezuelan currency, all right? So anytime you get some Venezuelan currency, your instinct is to convert it to anything else, dollars, euros, whatever you can find, and hold it in that form. Well, in the old days, and still to this day, a number of countries prohibit the freedom of people to hold stash their wealth in anything except the domestic currency. So that's a type of freedom that we measure in this index. The fourth area is free trade. This is the one, as I mentioned, Adam Smith is kind of the most famous for. Again, it was a crazy argument in 18th century England to argue that they should trade freely with the French. It's still a crazy argument today. In my country, there's a current little fracas going on with regard to Mexican tomatoes. Some people are apparently very, very upset that I, Bob Lawson, living in Dallas, Texas, can buy Mexican tomatoes. Now, who do you think is really upset about me buying Mexican tomatoes? American tomato farmers are probably very upset about this. And so, and very impassioned letters to the editor, very impassioned op-eds are being written, and people are giving talks about how it's just horrible that these Mexicans are giving us these tomatoes so cheaply and so tasty. So we have measures of tariffs. We also have some measures from the World Bank and the World Economic Forum of non-tariff barriers. We have capital control measures here. These are all pretty easy things to measure. We do have one that I really like. We added it about 3-4 years ago, and it's travel visas, tourist class travel visas. How easy is it not to take a good from across the border, but how easy is to take a person across the border? And so we've got a new measurement of simple tourist class travel. And some countries, it's very easy to visit them. No visa requirements, just go, you know, get off the plane and you're there. Thank you, Israel, for not making me get a visa. But a lot of countries are very strict, including my own. The United States actually gets a very low score on that particular measure. The last one is regulation of credit, labor, and business. A lot of variables, actually. I think there's probably 10 or 12 variables. Various aspects of regulations. Now, regulations are very idiosyncratic from place to place around the world. Some places have weird regulations that no one else has. From my point of view, I can't measure that. I could give one country a zero and everybody else a 10 or something. The kind of regulatory measures we have in here are really only the kinds that pretty much almost everybody has. So, for example, minimum wages. Most countries have a minimum wage of some sort or another. Turns out it's fiendishly difficult to measure minimum wages around the world because they come in very many sizes and types. A lot of countries have a very simple one like the United States where it's pretty much one size fits all, but a lot of countries have, well, it's this much for agricultural workers, this much for manufacturing workers, and this much for teenagers, this much for adults, and it's actually pretty hard to measure. But thank you, World Bank, they did it, so I just grabbed their numbers from the Doing Business Project. There's one variable also from the World Bank. How many days does it take to start a business? They go through a process of trying to, they don't actually create the business, but they actually go through the sort of thought process of how hard is it to create a business in different countries. And it's a simple business. I think it's a warehouse. So not a nuclear power plant or anything, you know. And so how long would it take to start a warehouse in Cairo? How long would it take to start a warehouse in Washington, D.C.? How long would it take to do in Lima, Peru, wherever? And in the United States, they say 30 days. If you want to start a simple business in the United States, no real crazy. I mean, a nuclear power plant would take a decade. But, you know, just starting a warehouse, just, you know, in terms of the legal process.
Yes, 143 days.
100 how many?
43.
So 30 days in the United States, 143. I'll look that up. It's in there. All right. I haven't looked at it recently, but the last, and it's been, so it's probably wrong, different now, but I looked at it at one point in Cairo, in Egypt, it was 3,000 days. That's what they said. It would take 3,000 days to legally go through the Egyptian paperwork, and it was like 24 different government offices you had to visit. And I mean, this is just a nightmare in my mind. Well, obviously what happens in a country like that, if you want to start a business? You start it anyway illegally, you bribe your way so that eight years turns into, you know, 8 days, or you don't start it at all. That's a really interesting question about how corruption works in terms of economic freedom. I have a very sort of moderately sanguine view of corruption. All right, so these are the things. 42 variables, that's just sort of the surface level of the thing. So I crunch all these numbers into my computer, squeeze them in, I turn a crank, and zeros and tens pop out. 10 is what Adam Smith wanted the world to be. Zero's the opposite of what Adam Smith wanted it to be. Or maybe that's what Karl Marx wanted to be. That's debatable. But anyway, 10 is Smith. If you're a Marxist and you just want to invert that scale, I don't care. It's completely arbitrary. But this is an economic freedom index, so higher numbers mean more economic freedom, more natural liberty, more capitalism in the classic sense. So who's number one? Everybody here maybe knows this. Yeah. Hong Kong is number one, and I did not need to spend the last 25 years of my life throwing 250,000 numbers into my computer to know this. Hong Kong's top tax rate, top rich people tax rate, 15%. Actually, the bottom tax rate, it's a flat tax. 15%. In the United States, depending on what state you live in, the top tax rate is 50%. France was 75%. They may have just lowered it to 60% or something. Yeah. So this is just the personal income tax, right? Just the personal income tax rate. Property rate, property taxes. If Peter Lewin stole my $5 by not washing my car, I would actually rather end up in front of a Hong Kong judge than a Texas judge. Their courts are staffed with well-educated, impartial judges. In fact, it's an enviable legal system. Inflation is no major problem. It's tied to the dollar, so I should maybe say it's no major problem yet, but it's no big deal. What's the tariff rate in Hong Kong? It's zero. They don't have any tariffs. So. Wow, I mean, people call me crazy for saying we should not have tariffs. No, everyone has tariffs. What are you, crazy person? Oh, Hong Kong doesn't have tariffs. And, you know, people say, well, it's a small country. Oh, it's about the size of Israel. So, I mean, it's you know, a small country, but it's just because it's geographically small, it's got, you know, 9 million people in it or something. So, how many days does it take to start a business in Hong Kong? One day. Actually, I think it's noon. They just rounded up to one. Actually, John Stossel, that crazy American journalist, he went to Hong Kong, and it turns out he did it. It was one office. He went in, he filled out a form, he gave him $25, and he walked out, and he was legally a business in Hong Kong. It literally did take that. It was that easy. So that gives you an indication. If any other country had come out first, we would have scrapped the project because that had to be number one. I mean, everything we know about Hong Kong is number one. After that, though, my priors get a little, I'm not really sure who should be 2 or 4 or 14 or 17, you know, 56. I mean, these numbers, I really don't have that much. But when you look at some of the countries here, there's some pretty good things. Singapore is number 2. This affords me an opportunity to mention that this is not an index of political rights and civil liberties. There are indices of political rights and civil liberties. For example, Freedom House in New York does one. There are some other ones out there. I love political rights. I love civil liberties. Freedom of speech, worship the God of your choice and the manner of your choosing. All that stuff is fantastic. I like that stuff even more, perhaps, than economic freedom. But our index is silent on those things. What we saw when we started this project in the 90s is that no one was paying enough attention or any attention to measuring the economic side of our freedoms. And there was a lot of attention paid to civil liberties and freedom of speech, political participation, voting, things like that. And those are all important things. So Singapore, of course, is not the world's best example of a liberal democracy. It's an autocracy. It's not a totalitarian state by any stretch of the means, but it's an autocracy. It's not a very good democracy. You do not write an op-ed criticizing the ruling party in Singapore, at least if you plan on staying in Singapore very long. And as far as civil liberties concerned, don't smoke any weed there. You know, it's very bad, not just for your health or whatever. It's bad, you know, so on. So, but other than that, New Zealand, Switzerland, skip on down, New United Kingdom, Canada. We do have some recent additions, and I'm a little bit uncomfortable, in fact, and it's not just because I'm in Israel, that United Arab Emirates and Jordan are now scoring very high on our index. And again, I just put the numbers in. The numbers we're putting in the index are the same numbers we've been putting in the index for a decade, 15 years. And what's happened is Emirates especially, but even in Jordan, have really just risen a lot on the index. Now, not all the Arab, Saudi Arabia's in the index, and they score like crap. So it's not a general phenomenon. But there are some of the countries that have gone way up on the index. The best way I have to explain it is twofold. Number one is we are not particularly tuned in this index to gender issues. And it's not because we don't care about this, we just really don't have any good data on this. I mean, we don't have data that we're comfortable using. So United Emirates is probably a pretty good place to buy and sell, import, export, hire and fire, as long as you're a Muslim male. If you're female or not Muslim, perhaps it's a little bit more difficult. But our data don't really give us that degree of nuance. It's just they don't. Okay. So this is one of the challenges for us from a measurement point of view. The second thing is, that's both of them. That's really what I'm going to say. Okay. Chile is 10th or 13th. Okay. So they're just off of this list. I mean, they're very high. Now, the United States is now 16th. In many ways, this is the biggest news of the index in the last few years, is the United States has fallen. In fact, it's fallen from number 2. If I insert the United States' rating in 2000, it was an 8.65 on our 10-point scale, and now it's a 7.773 on our 10-point scale. So it's about a 0.9 of a point drop. Now, these are index numbers. They don't have any units to them. But that's about a standard deviation decline in our index. So that's a big decline. It's a meaningful decline. The range of our index is about from a 3 to a 9. So going down by one unit is not a trivial decline. The United States, in fact, is the second largest declining country over this period, with the exception of Venezuela. And one never wants to be on a list that also includes Venezuela, right? So the United States has gone from second in the world, 8.65, to 7.73, and that's sort of being the big thing that we've noticed. And I don't want to talk about it right now, but maybe in Q&A we can talk about why that's the case. But that's sort of the big thing. So one of the cool things about this project is we can track countries as they go down and up the index. Now, I probably shouldn't say this with the man who's giving me a paycheck at the end of this week, but I was too lazy or incompetent to throw Israel on here, but I did look up the numbers. Israel in the year 1980, what do you think on a 10-point scale the rating was? 3.5. And they were ranked 99th out of 120-some countries. So pretty much the bottom of the barrel. What do you think the rate, what's the rating today? It's 7. Forgive me for not having memorized them all. 7.38 and ranked 39th in the world out of 157. So one of the really valuable aspects of our project is that you can track countries over time as well. It's not just that you can compare countries today with each other, but you can follow countries as they go up and down the scale. Now, the United States decline from this to that is a pretty modest decline in comparison to going from a 3.5 to a 7.4, which is what Israel has done. That goes all the way back to 1980 for that particular measure. So big increases for Israel. And the talk I'm giving on Wednesday, whatever the day is, that talk is actually going to focus a little bit on the Israeli, the path that Israel's taken in the index. All right. Now here are some other countries. It's 157, so it's too many to throw them all up like this. The colors do represent quartiles, though, so just give you a flavor. Blue is the top 25%, green second 25, yellow is the third, and the red is, had to use red for the bottom 25%, right? I mean, that makes sense. So give you an idea where countries are. Now, United States, despite being 16th and gone down by almost a full point, is still in the top 25% of the world, so we're not a socialist country yet. But I get a lot of questions about India and also China. You can see they're basically tied with each other, and they score in that sort of third quartile, but they're really pretty close to the fourth quartile. They're right on that yellow and red border. Right now they're in the yellow side. China is a very hard country. We have what's the saying in China? One country, two systems with respect to Hong Kong. Well, forget about Hong Kong. Even within China, there are a dozen systems, 15 systems. I mean, in fact, inside of China, you have people like in Shanghai who are probably living in conditions, economically freedom conditions, that aren't terribly different than Hong Kong. Like, arguably some of the most free people economically in the world. And then you have other provinces and other areas of China where you probably have some of the least free people in the world. So the very same country within it has the full range of economic freedom experiences for human beings. We only give one country one number. Okay, and at the end of the day, they don't get a very good score, despite all the press about China's move towards liberalization, and they have clearly liberalized. I mean, 111 out of 100. Where would they have been in 1980? Dead last, right, or second to last, maybe North Korea or something. You know, Soviet Union was. You know, then they would have been really bad. So they've come up. They've liberalized a lot. Our numbers show a lot of movement up for India and China, but let's not exaggerate the fact that they are not free market countries, or anything close to that. I'll give you one data point on China that emphasizes this point. All of the domestic banks are owned by the government in China. All of them. Now, okay, what does that mean? Well, what that means is that if you're a Chinese citizen, a domestic citizen, and you want to open or expand your business and want to do so with some bank credit, you have to go to a government official to get that loan. And that loan is not evaluated just on the merits of your business plan, your creditworthiness, and so on. It's based on whether or not you are friendly to the regime, whether or not you cracked a bad joke about the premier or whatever. So the entire domestic credit system is politicized. Now, this doesn't matter for Nike and Reebok because they have access to world capital markets. They don't need to borrow from Chinese banks. But for Chinese people who are trying to start in businesses and so on, that ownership of the credit system by the government, I mean, that's a massive politicization of one of the most fundamental aspects of any economy, and that's how you get credit, how we handle credit. India's got similar kind of problems. India and China are different in so many ways, but they both have sort of partially liberalized. China is partially liberalized by area of the country, geographically. India is liberalized partially, but by sector of the economy. So certain sectors are quite liberal, whilst other sectors are quite tightly controlled. Okay, so they've had piecemeal regulation in both places, but in different ways. And they both get pretty low scores. All right, the cover of the book always has a map like this. And this is it's a geography test for the poor American, actually. Now, we don't have ratings for all the countries in the world. So you'll see North Korea is gray. No North Korea. Why no North Korea? No data. Now, I know where they go, right? They go last. Okay, but we don't have data. The World Economic Forum doesn't get to give their survey there, right? So no data. Same thing with Sudan. Same thing with, obviously, Somalia. But we got most countries. We don't have Cuba either for the same reason. But we're getting pretty good now. Iraq, Afghanistan, again, kind of failed states we don't really have data for. But we've gotten most of the countries now in there. As you can see, Israel is blue. It's not easy to see because it's so small, but it's blue, meaning Israel is in the top 25% of the rankings. As I said, what color would they have been in 1980 if we had this map? They would have been red. They would have been in the bottom quartile. So that's one of the most impressive stories that we can track. But my favorite area is to look at the old Soviet Union. Now, this we did not have a Soviet Union score for 1980 or even 1990 for the same reason we don't have North Korea today. No data on the Soviet Union. But, I mean, obviously, this entire area up here would have been red, right, in 1990, 24 years ago, 5 years ago. And now you see some interesting things. You see the Baltics, Latvia, Lithuania, and Estonia scoring pretty high. Estonia scores, I think, 14th out of in the world. Pretty impressive. My favorite country in the world is this one, which you all know is Georgia. And when I give this in America, I say, what country is that? And like, people just they stare at me like, I don't know. And then I say Georgia, and they're like, no, Georgia's over here. So it doesn't help. So that's Georgia. Now, Georgia's, I think, even more impressive than the Baltics. Because Georgia was taken over by the Tsar in like 1811 or something. So, I mean, Georgia has basically been under the thumb of Russia and then the Soviet Union for all of its modern history, with a very short period during the Bolshevik Revolution where they declared independence, and then a week later the Soviets came, so that didn't last. That was a Soviet Socialist Republic. I mean, an embedded, integral part of Soviet Russia, Georgia. They are ranked 19th or something now. It may be 16th, whatever it is. But that's stunning. And most of that actually has happened since 2004. So from 2004 to our most recent data, which are actually two years old, 2013, Georgia went from Soviet-like conditions to conditions that we measure to be as economically free as places like, actually better than the United States. Actually, I think they're higher than the United States, so it must be they must be like 16th or something or whatever. That's cool. Now, it's still a poor country. Georgia's poor. I think their per capita GDP is $5,000 or something. It's not a rich country. They've been growing pretty well, but you know, that's pretty cool. The other thing that's pretty neat, although it doesn't look like it's neat here, is Africa. Africa looks pretty awful, right? And you kind of expect that when you think of bad governments and high regulations and bad property rights. Africa, you know, comes to mind. Also Latin America. There is a little bit of a lesson here, though, is that this map is done by ranking, right? Reds are 25% of the map by design, and that's misleading. Every year, 25% of the countries are going to be red. What we don't see here is if you look at the actual numbers, look at the actual data, African countries are going up, and they're going up very rapidly. They used to be threes and fours. Now they're fours, fives, sixes, and a couple of them are sevens. Little Rwanda, which, you know, Rwandan genocide not too long ago, is actually blue. They cracked into the top 25%. Don't ask me why. I'm lucky, again, you're lucky I can find it on a map. But you know, you're seeing even the red countries, the numbers are getting better. They're still about 25%, but they're getting better. Some of the greener countries, Kenya, Botswana, Zambia, South Africa is kind of truly a special case. But a lot of the countries, especially Anglophone, former English colonies, their numbers are really getting borderline respectable. I am not an investment advice type guy, but I really do think some of these African countries are going to grow like mad once the world sort of stabilizes its situation with the financial crisis. You know, we saw some growth rates in South and Southeast Asia, you know, Malaysia, Thailand, Indonesia, Philippines. We saw some growth rates, you know, 9, 10, 12% a year for a generation. And these countries went from very, very poor to middle-income countries inside of a generation. I think that's going to happen in Africa. Not all of Africa, but the parts of Africa that are really getting their policies stabilized, and our numbers are starting to reflect that. We'll see. Again, I wouldn't put all my money in the Zambian stock market, but nevertheless, if there is one. Over in North America, Chile is obviously the only real economically free country. Peru doesn't score too bad, but other than that, South America is pretty bad. Central America has gotten much more stable and economically free. I get a lot of questions about Nicaragua. How come Nicaragua is so high? Aren't they run by communists? And they are. Daniel Ortega is a communist. He wears fatigues and red armbands. That's what a communist is, right? But Daniel Ortega is a crazy, he's a cagey guy. When he's in Nicaragua, he puts on his fatigues, and he talks like Chavez and Castro, and power to the people. And then he puts on a suit and he flies to New York and he talks to investment bankers about how they can finance more sweatshops in Nicaragua. So he's a smooth talking, he's a politician, he lies to his people. He says he's not lying actually, he's doing better work in New York getting sweatshops to move to Nicaragua. That's actually the good stuff. So the index is it's kind of fun to compare countries, but I really enjoy following the countries over time, having a time series that you can track. And again, Israel turns out to be one of the more interesting countries. All right. Why do we do this? Well, partly I did that because I think this is cool. I mean, just having these numbers is cool. I'm not going to argue that we have every number right. That's silly, right? This is a very crude indicator of what, but you know, I'm pretty sure the blue countries are freer than the red countries, and most of the green ones are freer than the yellow ones. We've got some numerical way of tracking whether countries are following Adam Smith's recipe or Karl Marx's recipe. And that's valuable. And I think just having the map and just being able to measure economic freedom is a worthwhile exercise. I can tell you I've learned a lot. I thought I knew what economic freedom was. I mean, I read Hayek, I read Smith, I read Milton Friedman. Milton Friedman's a hero of mine. I'm a libertarian. I know what freedom is. That's what and then you sit down and you try to measure it, and you go, wait, I'm not sure I understand it really as well as I think I do. So just the act of measuring economic freedom has taught me a lot about what freedom really is. Lord Kelvin's famous line was, to measure is to know. I think there's a lot of truth in that. To measure something is to know it, and you really do learn something about a thing by trying to measure it. But at the end of the day, the reason we did this was to sort of ask the question, who was right, Smith or Marx? Smith said economic freedom works. Marx said, no, it doesn't. Well, we have a measurement of economic freedom. We also have all kinds of measures of things we like in this world and things we don't like in this world. Most of us like GDP. Notwithstanding some qualms about every aspect of it, GDP, to the extent it measures us producing goods and services that we value as human beings, sounds like a good thing. And it turns out countries that are blue on that map have a GDP per capita on average of $38,000. By the way, not every country is that rich. Georgia is blue and they're $5,000. But on average, the blue countries score very high on our index. And you can see it just goes right on down. And Adam Smith was right. The system of natural liberty or economic freedom gives us more wealth in the nation. And we have some data to support that hypothesis. Now, this would not have surprised Karl Marx, actually. Karl Marx actually knew and admitted that capitalism was very productive. But what? But it screws the poor. Too much inequality, right? Those are the kinds of complaints that Marx had. So, well, I went and I got some data on inequality. Now, this is not the Gini coefficient that a lot of people use. I could do that. It looks pretty much the same. But the World Bank has income share of the bottom 10%. So this is the percentage of total income that the poorest 10% of the population earns. Now, if we had perfect income equality, the bottom 10% would have 10% of the income. Okay? And what you see is you go around the world, whether you're in a economically free country, say a blue country, or a less economically free one, green, yellow, or red, what you see is, no matter where you are, the poorest tenth of the population gets somewhere between 2-3% of total income. There isn't a pattern across the world between economic freedom, or economically free countries, or freer countries, and income inequality. Now, this picture should surprise the heck out of Karl Marx. Karl Marx thought the blue countries should be less free than the red countries. The red countries are taxing and regulating, trying to make people free. Turns out it's not really happening. That's a flat line. There have been a number of, this is not a very sophisticated analysis, a bar chart, right? Not very sophisticated. Those of you who are econometric students are like, what is this? You know, what is this? If you do econometrics with the proper controls, you don't find it either. So everything I'm saying here with these simple charts is backed up, in fact, even more so in many cases, with more sophisticated analysis. It is, in fact, a myth that economically free countries generate more inequality. I don't care what Thomas Piketty says. He has three countries of data in his state, by the way. I got 100. I win, right? This is actually the large part of my rant that I will start, begin the end of my talk on. When people are debating with each other about how the world works, all too often, I do it, you do it, everyone does it, all sides do it, they cherry pick their data. They pick the two observations that fit their case. It happens with respect to Sweden and the United States all the time. Everybody loves Sweden. Hell, I love Sweden. Sweden's nice. If you've been there, it's really a nice place. If the United States turned into Sweden, if every country in the world turned into Sweden, this would be a good world to live in. I would quit my job and go get an honest job if the whole world turned into Sweden. If that's the worst case for the world, I'll take it. Okay? But they cherry pick their data. They'll say, well, look, you know, Sweden is less economically free than the United States. That's true. They have higher taxes, more regulations, and so on. And they have more equality. So, you know, two dots. That's a relationship. By the way, if you're an econometric student, when you have two dots, you get a perfect R squared. It's the best regression you ever run, right? What's the problem? I got 100 dots. If you put 100 dots, economic freedom, income inequality, it looks like a shotgun. There's no pattern there. You don't see it in the bar chart. You don't see it in the, it's not there. So don't let your ideological opponents, whether you're left wing, right wing, in the middle wing, whatever you are, don't let the people you're debating about a particular point, don't let them cherry pick data. If we have 100 countries and you're trying to make a general point about how free countries, or how economic freedom works with income inequality, use all 100 countries. I think there's 112 countries in that data, in that variable, in this chart. I have a whole bunch of these. I'm only going to show you these four. You'll be happy to know. This is income of the poorest 10%, not the share, but the income level of the poorest 10%. As far as I know, I'm the only person that calculates this. If you look at the income level of the poorest 10th, it's about $10,000 on average for the poorest 10% of the people in the blue countries. It's not a lot of money. I would not want to live on $10,000 in the United States. But $10,000 is certainly a bit nicer than $1,600, which is what the poorest of the poor get in the red countries. Per person. This is per capita. And it's purchasing power parity, yeah. Yeah. So it's the best numbers we have. I mean, the point is, even if there's measurement error here, this is almost an order of magnitude difference. Whatever measurement error here is not that big. I'm not sure. I don't think so in the case, because this is global data, usually not.
Do you have median assessments instead of averages?
No, you don't. No one does. It's not a matter of me choosing it.
Would that be a better assessment of how the average
is? Probably not. Probably not at this level of analysis. I mean, I mean, again, if I compare my average to your average, you know, it might be like this difference, but the difference between, I don't think would be that different. But the bottom line is, there is some distributional data, but there, if you know where I can get for 100 plus countries data on median income, send me that file, because I'm pretty sure it doesn't exist. The other one I like a lot, and I usually end on this one, is life expectancy. I like it for a couple reasons. One is life expectancy data are really good. You guys are already jumping me on the data. You're right to do so. When someone makes a claim with data, you should really be careful. What is the data? Where'd you get it? What does it measure? You know, that's all excellent stuff. The nice thing about life expectancy is it's pretty easy to measure. Pretty much it's tracking when people are born and when they die, and then demographers do some magic mathematics to figure out what they think life expectancy is. And even the crappiest places in the world can pretty much track where you're born and when you die. So it's good quality data for lots of countries. So it's kind of nice. And in some ways, it's a summary statistic. It's capturing income, because richer people probably live longer, they're healthier. It captures whether you have water treatment plants or, you know, disease, healthcare, all kinds of things kind of get wrapped up into life expectancy. So it's kind of a nice summary statistic. It's not like happiness maybe, but it's a summary statistic on whether things are pretty good or not in that place. And you see there's almost a 20-year difference. It's gone down actually a little bit. It's about a 17-year difference between the reds and the blues. And that's a pretty big difference. If you live to be 80 years old, you're going to live long enough to see your grandchildren be born, you're going to see your grandchildren grow up, and you're probably going to see your grandchildren grow up, great-grandchildren grow up even, right? My daughter's 20 years old, so roughly speaking, most of your age, maybe a little younger. She has a close relationship with two of her great-grandparents. Great-grandparents. She's 20 years old. And she probably will get married, and her great-grandparents will see her. They even might see her great-grand-grandkids. I don't know what kind of condition my grandma and grandpa will be in at that point, but and I'm not in any great hurry to be a grandfather myself, but that's amazing that people are living long enough to enjoy their grandkids and their great-grandkids and maybe their great-great-grandkids. This is a stunning thing. Most human beings that ever lived were dead before their grandkids came around, much less their great-grandkids. And they certainly didn't seem to grow up. So economic freedom, to the extent it brings us higher incomes and better health care and all this other good stuff, it also gives us something else. It gives us a chance to see our grandkids grow up. And that's pretty special. Peter, it's pretty special, isn't it? You know, okay. Grandparents say it's great. Apparently it's a law of the universe that you can't become a grandparent without first being a parent, which is unfortunate because I hear being a grandparent's the greatest thing in the world, but being a parent's maybe not. So, all right. Now, I don't know what's in your head right now, but when I do this for the American audience, frequently I'm getting a lot of, well, duh, Lawson. Everybody knows markets are better than socialism. Lower taxes are better than higher taxes. Blah, blah, blah. Everybody, Soviet Union fell. I mean, come on. You're preaching the obvious. I worry that people think I'm preaching the obvious. Well, let me show you a graph. It's not my graph. It's kind of fuzzy. It's from a 1964 textbook. A textbook from the year 1964. On the horizontal axis, if you can't read, that says 1960, 70, 80, 90, and 2000. The vertical axis, it says relative growth rates. I think it's measuring income, but on a log scale. It's not really clear. Textbook author wasn't really keen on measuring exactly what he was measuring. But anyway, he has the U.S. here, and the U.S. starts at 100. I don't know what that means. This is 100, okay.
What year was this done?
1964. So this is a forecast. And this is the Soviet Union, USSR. So Soviet Union, whoever drew this picture said, in 1960, the Soviet Union was about half as rich as the United States. Okay, I don't know, maybe it was a third as rich, whatever. Anyway, he said 150, okay? And then he made a projection, because this was drawn in 1964, so this is basically a forecast of the future. And you can see the Soviet Union is going to grow very fast, the U.S. is going to grow very slow, and somewhere right around 1990, the Soviet Union is going to surpass the United States in per-person income and be richer than the United States. This, of course, is spectacularly wrong, right? In the history of bad forecasts.
How do you know that was the exact time? That
I know, it's amazing. Actually, that part of it's pretty cool, isn't it? He timed something right, exactly the opposite of what he... Anyway, so yeah, this is spectacularly wrong. Spectacularly wrong. Now, who drew this picture? It's an economics textbook. Everyone in the United States, and for that matter, most people in the world, Paul Samuelson. This is Paul Samuelson's picture. Paul Samuelson was not a dumb man. Paul Samuelson was a Nobel laureate. He got his, I think he graduated from Harvard at age 11 or something. I mean, he was a savant, all right? He's really, really smart. I'm from the public schools. I am not really smart. So people like me actually do like it when smarter people make stupid mistakes because it makes us feel better about ourselves. This is horrible. This picture actually was in there for 10 years. As late as 1989, notice the date, as late as 1989, this is a sentence from his textbook, an American economics textbook taught to, over the years, millions of American students. What counts as results, and there can be no doubt that the Soviet planning system has been a powerful engine of economic growth. Oh yeah, by the way, there's been some human costs, but let's forget about that. This guy, who was one of the smartest people, and he was not a communist, no fatigues, no red armbands. He was a Democrat. Now, in Texas, Democrats are considered communists, but in most places, Democrats are just Democrats. They're pretty normal people. This is really bad. What actually happened? We now know what actually happened. The lines actually, instead of getting closer, they actually got further apart. The Soviet Union was growing slower. The United States was growing faster. The gap was widening, not narrowing. And the Soviet system of planning was not a powerful engine for economic growth. In fact, by 1990, right when that was written, right when we the Soviet economy was an empty eggshell. And all that had to happen was a little flick, and it just collapsed. And there was nothing but air there. All right? That's what actually happened. So now, the question I have for you is, what was wrong with Paul Samuelson's analysis? He was clearly wrong in his analysis. What was wrong with it? Well, you could say he was a commie, but I've already said that's not the answer. He could have been an ideological communist. Maybe the KGB was paying him to put that in his textbook. No, I don't think that's the case. I think, I don't think he even used the data. But partly it is, the data were wrong, but I don't think he ever even looked at the data. Because if you looked at the data, people who were looking at the data carefully knew better. A guy named Warren Nutter at University of Virginia was really making calling this stuff out. I don't know. I really don't know. Cambridge, you know, the thing is about a Harvard professor or an MIT professor, you could just sit in Cambridge and you just know the world right there. I don't know. I think he's wrong just because he didn't have any data. It wasn't that he even had bad data. I don't think he bothered to look at the data that was there. I think he simply was blinded by his ideological view of the world, that central planning was a more productive force than his model of the world was planning would be more productive than markets. And he just drew a picture that said that was going to be the case. Today, if you have that picture in your textbook, we know it's wrong. And the reason we know it's wrong in part is because we got graphs like this. We got pictures like this say, well, look, you know, the planning systems, the red systems don't do as well as the blue systems. The unplanned systems do better. So I think having data in the analysis is the big difference between today's world and the world of Paul Samuelson. And I am actually done. Those are our websites, but Larry has a question.
So does that say anything about the value of the stuff in the rest of the textbook?
Well, I don't know. Yeah, Larry, we're open for questions now. So.
It's actually more scandalous than just that one diagram.
It is.
He had two data points. He had the relative incomes at one point. When he updated the textbook, he noticed that the gap hadn't actually closed. So he changed the dates on the horizontal axis, but didn't change the projection.
Yeah, actually, I have that chart too. Instead of starting at 60, it starts at 70, but it's exactly identical in every other respect, so it is. Yes?
What data points do you wish you could add into your 40 table? Let alone the extra work, but say, pop down in the fire.
Well, that's a long list. From the mundane variables that I would love to have a government employment number. I'd like to know what percentage of the population is working for the government. Turns out that's an impossible number to get outside the OECD. At a more serious level, I would love to get a measure of immigration restrictiveness. I have a sort of hardcore libertarian view that if we're going to measure how hard it is to move a box of bananas across the border, we should also measure how hard it is to move a human being across the border. That doesn't mean you should necessarily be in favor of more or less immigration, but I think we ought to measure it, and we don't. There's just really no good international measures of restrictiveness in that. I would love, as I mentioned with the UAE thing, I would love to add some kind of way for us to pick up the gender nuance, at least, if not other types of minority issues. Those are the top ones. I mean, some of them are pretty mundane, but some of them are pretty big. Yeah.
I have two questions. First one, I want to be a devil's advocate. Wealth comes first because of some discovery or some fortuitous event or some scientific discovery in certain fields. And because of wealth, people become smarter, well informed, and then freedom rises with that information and with that knowledge. In other words, what is this reverse relation? I'm just looking at that.
Sure.
I'm a real born again.
Yeah, I see. I wish we had longer time series. We have data back to 1970. And all of the time series numbers that we do, where you basically do that kind of thing, and we've done it both ways, like income first, everything is saying the freedom has to come before. I mean, you know, so if you look at the economic freedom at the beginning of a period and growth after, the growth comes after. People that grow fast 10 years ago, there's no relationship with what happens to economic freedom later on. So people have done causality studies. To the extent you can do those with statistics, causality is a deeply philosophical and theoretical concept, but to the extent the data are informing us on that, there's just no real evidence of the reverse causality.
Yeah. All right, so that's a good thing. The second question is this. You said you weighted all that equally, 20, each category, 20%, which, and of course that's an arbitrary way of putting it, but you have no other way of doing it. If I assume that the single most egregious, most damaging, less transparent damage in an economy's regulation, because we don't know the exact effect of it, we don't know what it does. In other words, if the government has monetary restrictions or trade restrictions, I know what they are. I can deal with them. I can get around them. I can bribe an official, or I don't even have to bribe an official. I can, you know, be friendly to him and let me start a new factory. Unless the regulation is the one single, and you weighted that to 50%. Will there be any results?
Yeah, so one of the things we do with our index is we're extraordinarily transparent about it, not only in the book, but we give out the file, the Excel file. It's quite large. But people have done exactly what you're suggesting. It turns out that most of the time these policies are pretty correlated. So countries that have a lot of regulation tend to have a lot of, you know, monetary mischief or protectionism and so on and so forth. So if you reweight things, you don't actually dramatically alter the results. Now, I say that with some trepidation, because if you do something really extreme, you will find some individual countries really dropping, because there are going to be some cases like that. But actually, the index is pretty robust to different weighting systems. We've actually, in the history of the project, we go back to 1996 on this. We ourselves have used different weighting systems. We've done everything from high-tech principal component analysis to create weights to low-tech averages, which I like because it's easy, and easy to explain as well. It turns out it really hasn't mattered a lot. So I get requests all the time. We don't actually give out the formulas because it just would be a big spreadsheet. That'd be a mess. But I get requests pretty often for people who say, hey, can you drop a variable? In other words, take a variable and make it zero weight.
So, can I follow just the regulation part?
Oh, yeah, sure.
Who has the highest?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, we give out all the individual data, and you can absolutely track over time. So you can pull out the parts that you think are most important. More generally, though, what's funny about that is, man, you give this talk in Sweden, and all they want to talk about is taxes. You know, you go to Latin America, and it's all about property rights and rule of law. Yeah, I'm sure if I was in Zimbabwe, all they'd want to talk about is inflation. So what's most important, it turns out, is highly contextual. And, you know, if you put all of us in the room together, we're all going to be arguing, no, that's more. So there isn't one obvious thing that's most important philosophically. And when I talk to people, it turns out it's wherever you're from and whatever issue your particular country has the biggest problem, and that's the thing you think is most important.
Well, the question for me is, yeah, which is the most,
yeah,
transparent?
Yeah, I see.
Because
yeah,
you can adapt,
sure,
to others.
Yes.
Do you have any time series graphs? And also, based on the data you have, are you planning on doing any projections or interested in?
I do have time series. I don't have any really accessible in the moment. I, for the United States, I do, because I give most of my talks, obviously, in the U.S. And the U.S. having gone down a lot, I have a lot of charts that sort of track for different components how that's trended. You know, you're adding another dimension. The cross-sectional dimension is one thing. You add the time series dimension, it really gets more difficult. So I don't have a lot of readily available things. Those things exist, but, you know. I just put the numbers in. I try to not think much about them. I don't want to bias things much. And if I started saying I think this is going to happen, I would worry that I would want to make it happen. I don't want to do that. I can tell you that I would have already lost the bet with Jim. Jim Gortney said the U.S. was going to fall, and I said, "Nah, Jim, come on, it's not that bad. We're second, we're third, whatever. It's not that bad." And he saw that going down. So I know from my own experience that I'm a pretty poor projector going forward. It is neat though when you see a change in the numbers and then you go read it, you Google it, because I don't know most of these countries. So I put you see a country make a jump over 4 or 5 years, and then all you got to do is Google Rwanda, you know, economic liberalism Rwanda, you know, Google search. all of a sudden you get a whole, like, oh wow, look at that, I didn't know that. You know, the numbers are actually tracking real stuff, so that's kind of nice. But I don't do projections.
Yes, sir.
How do you calculate the average that we saw on the last charts? I mean, when we look at it, is every country get a number and you calculate the average, or each person get a vote?
Those are unweighted averages by country. So I don't weight China, India anymore. I've actually done that. About every 2 or 3 years, someone like you will ask me to do it, and I'll do it. It's actually not it's not the simplest thing in the world to do like population weighting averages. It's a pain in the neck, to be honest. And I do it, and actually, I mean, the numbers change, but there's no pattern that really alters. So even though China and India's numbers would balloon their weight, it turns out the sort of pattern, the way those things work, doesn't really change. So I do it every 3 or 4 years just to be honest with myself when I make this answer, but it doesn't really matter. It's kind of surprising because, I mean, you know, obviously, how many Israels are there in China? I mean, do the math. It's a lot, right?
So they should get a lot more weight.
Why did U.S. assets decline? Is it gotten bigger in the last year as well?
Yeah, well, one of the things I've learned about this index is that it correlates very poorly with political parties. You'll see the index go up with nominally left-wing parties in power. You'll see the index go down with nominally right-wing or so-called business-friendly parties in power. New Zealand's, a lot of New Zealand's liberalization occurred under Labor governments in New Zealand, for example. In the United States, the declines began in 2000. Under George W. Bush. George W. Bush has an office on my campus. I see him on a fairly regular basis, which is really weird, actually. He knows about it. Actually, we spoke about it. We had dinner once, and we talked a little bit about it. I was trying to be nice. And, you know, he's not in power anymore. There's really no value in tweaking him over it. But the U.S. number went down. They went down under W. So about half of the decline, about half of that 0.9 unit decline was under a Republican, business-friendly, rah-rah, economic freedom Texan. And the commie from Illinois, it's still going down. I mean, so the point is, whether we had a free market-like guy or a labor Democrat, it didn't really matter. The thing was going down. It's gone down a pretty much straight line. And the answer to your question about why, though, is Area 2. When I talk to business Republicans, they all think it's taxes and debts. And yeah, the government of the United States is spending a lot more money and borrowing a lot more money and is bankrupting itself and maybe me in the process. It's a serious problem. Our fiscal situation is seriously bad. But that's not the big thing. The big decline in the United States is in the legal structure and property rights area. I'll give you one data point. In the impartiality of the courts, World Economic Forum survey, they give it every year. About 500 American businessmen, it's not the biggest survey in the planet, but 500 American businessmen, women. They ask them, how impartial are the judges? How fair are the judges? On a 10-point scale in the year 2000, the US got a 9 out of 10, which is about as good as anyone gets on a survey. In the last edition, it was like a 6.8. It's shocking. Now, you got to ask yourself, is that real? Are these business people just crazy? Maybe it was too high in 2000, maybe it's too low, I don't know. But I can tell you one example. In 2009, when Chrysler and General Motors were bankrupt, what should happen to a bankrupt company in the United States? I used to teach finance, so what happens? We all go to a room with a judge. All the creditors, all the people that are owed money, go to the room with GM and Chrysler, and everybody says, hey, they owe me money. They owe me money. Everybody puts their hand. I owe me money. Judge says, well, how much do they owe you? How much do they owe you? And of course, what's the problem? There isn't enough money to go around. That's why we're here. We're bankrupt. What should happen is the judge reads all these contracts. Okay, that contract says this, this contract says that. And the judge says, reading all these contracts, using the law, bankruptcy law, he says, okay, you're going to get so much money, you're going to get so much money, you're going to get so much money, and we're out now, so you guys are the shareholders, you get nothing. There's a process. There's a legal process for this. People spend years trying to learn and understand how this process works. What happened in 2009? President Obama. So now these guys are too important. We can't let a judge do this. I'm going to have a couple of my guys from the White House come in, and they're going to decide who gets the money. Now, who got the money? The labor unions got the money because they liked Obama. That is not an impartial legal system. That is a partial legal system. That system is partial to one side or another. And it was a major violation of the rule of law. And without exaggeration, hundreds of millions of dollars were stolen from the legal owners of that property, that wealth, that money. Chrysler and General Motors bondholders lost hundreds of millions of dollars that belonged to them. And it was, I think the word stolen is the appropriate word. So that's what's happening in the United States. And that's just one thing. I can go on with a whole litany of other things. That was during Obama. Oh, I think the war on drugs ramp ups and the war on terrorism ramp ups, the asset forfeiture, the RICO type stuff. I think a lot of that is the earlier period. Again, it's hard to put a finger on exactly, and it's hard to weight these various things because so many of these things are going on simultaneously. I only have one number, and it's a survey number. But I think that's a lot of those things.
Look, I'm not sure the dynamics are so different.
I think a lot of the measures that we have that are survey based, a lot of them are picking up the regulatory uncertainty. The question they say about judges, but they're also thinking in their heads, well, it's also the partiality of the control of the currency or the Federal Reserve Bank regulators or the EPA or OSHA, and the uncertainty associated with all these regulatory agencies. I think that's part of their mental model when they're putting these things down. So I do think that it's a lot of other things that maybe you wouldn't say is purely legal system stuff, but it's kind of filtering in. It's hard to say.
What seems to me a problem is the debate how you're weighting this or that or whatever. But you're not weighting the data based on thinking about assets. You come up with a way, you process the data, and then you look at the outcome. And the fact is there is a correlation that is compelling between economic freedom and prosperity.
Milton Friedman said if you wanted to measure the freedom of a country, you might look at the outcomes. Because if you wanted to measure the size of a car engine, you might just look at how fast the car goes. There's a correlation between the size of a car engine and how fast the car goes. But that's not what we're doing here. We're trying to measure the actual size of the car engine. We're trying to measure the actual amount of economic freedom. And so, yeah, the index is designed to only include policy inputs and not socioeconomic outcomes. And that's really hard to design because you're going to accidentally put in outcomes into the index. We've been very careful not to do that, I think. But I can tell you, I was much younger. I remember that first chart, the very first time I did that chart. And I had no idea. I was scared. I was like, what if this doesn't come out right? I mean, what happens if the reds are higher and the blues are lower? I mean, I'm pretty sure it's not going to happen. I kind of have a sense of this. But it was quite literally a moment in my life that I remember very clearly now. You put these numbers in and you're like, oh, it works. I sort of thought so, but now I'm like, now I kind of know so. So, yeah.
The income share of the bottom 10% as a percentage point, so was 2.4 to 2.1, roll back 2.5. Is, we've done this research for a long time, is it something that you believe is distinctively correlated to something, or just we're really, really crappy at taking care of the poor in our countries? Because the money is irrelevant. If you make $10,000 here in America, you're poor, poor as anything. That's an average, so I wouldn't say it's just a matter. But percentage-wise, we're not, in these our countries, we're not doing better than...
Inequality is a real thing in the world we live in. It's a realer thing in some places than other places. And I will freely admit, for example, the United States has a lot more inequality than our companion countries in, say, the OECD. Some people care a lot more about inequality than others. I'm in the middle of the road on that. I care about it. I care about it a lot. I don't care about it to the exclusion of everything else. All right? But I'll tell you, it's an intractable problem, in my opinion. It is what it is. And I think whatever the cause, I mean, you know, in Sweden, I think the number is about 4%. So, you know, and in Venezuela, it's like 1.8%. So you get a range that goes beyond the simple average, but it's not very wide. Like the most egalitarian societies in the world don't do all that much better, you know? And the most sort of unequal societies, you know, aren't that. So it's a very serious problem. It varies from place to place. It seems like it's correlated a lot by a region. Latin America's bad, Africa bad, Europe good. America, quite frankly, is more Latino than we are European in a lot of ways. Anytime someone compares us to Canada, I go, yeah, the problem is we're really more like Mexico than Canada in a lot of fundamental cultural ways. And so if you do that comparison, we always look good because Mexico's terrible, right? But not terrible, but, you know. So you'll see that it's something deeper, it's more historical, it's more cultural, it's more long-lasting than tariff rates or inflation rates or, you know, tax rates and things like that. Those policies matter for growth and income and maybe a lot of other things, as we can see in the other charts. But inequality is much more stable across countries, across time, and I am really at a loss. And I think anyone who says they understand inequality, they know what causes it, Thomas Piketty, I think they're kind of fooling themselves. I mean, I looked at these numbers, and you're just trying to look at the, I've read, I don't know, 50 academic studies on inequality, and there's just, it's all over the place. A lot of conjectures, the data just don't give us a lot of power. I wish we could tell you. Because then I could say, oh, well, if we'll do that. You know, if I found something that I thought really got rid of inequality, well, let's go do that. But I don't have anything. I know it gives me growth and income. Economic freedom does that pretty good. Everywhere it's tried, it works. So that I can tell you. I don't have a real easy solution.
Can I go to her first?
Yeah, it's really related.
Oh, sure.
One is like
the
climate change, since people say that inequality is leading people to climate. So like if you look at the index of 96, it's like 2.5% or whatever.
Yeah, I mean, it's, yeah, no. A tenth of a standard deviation. I mean, yeah, there's some trends that go up and down, but if you step back from the data and look at a lot of countries, you know, it's not gotten much worse or better. And then, actually, even if you got a little bit worse, you might have to say, okay, the world's gotten a lot richer. We're almost on the verge of eradicating extreme world poverty at the price of a small uptick in inequality. I think I'll take that trade. But that's a worthwhile conversation. But it's been, I would not defend the argument that we've had a lot more inequality in the world's countries. And I don't get the data back out.
To be honest, this looks very convincing. It's hard to argue the numbers. So I'm wondering why did Obama choose to give the money to the union? Why don't more countries adopt this way? What are
they
arguing against?
There's a lot to answer there, actually. Partly politicians are politicians. And the labor union is a big supporter of Obama, so it's not surprising that he wanted to do something for his people. That's what politicians do. So you don't blame lions for eating giraffes. That's what they do. You don't blame politicians for favoring the people that support them. That's what politicians do. So to me, that's not a terribly surprising phenomenon. What is a little bit surprising, perhaps, is why do just general people not see this so easily? And I think part of the reason is it's pretty complicated, actually. Our moral intuitions don't oftentimes coincide with this. One of our moral intuitions, for better or worse, as human beings, is sort of the in versus the outs. And you know, there's no problem in the state of Texas with Alabama tomatoes coming in. There's no border guard between Alabama There's no border between Alabama and Texas, actually. There's no problem with Louisiana tomatoes coming into the state of Texas. And the reason is, well, they're in. The Louisiana people they're in our club. They're in our tribe. Mexicans aren't in our tribe. They're outs. So our brains, our human brains, and we know this from sociopsychology, our brains are wired to put some people on the inside of our community and some people on the outside of our community. It sometimes correlates with geography, sometimes it correlates with religion, it can correlate with all kinds of things, but even if you don't do that, we'll find a way to make it happen as human beings, right? Like people who are fans of the Pittsburgh Steelers are evil people to me. I want them all to die. I'm exaggerating, only a little bit. So a lot of this freedom stuff requires you to transcend. Oh, what do you mean? I gotta let Mexicans send me tomatoes? We have to trade freely with them? We need to let more of them come here? We need to let them get licenses? Those people, how are we gonna, you know, that our brains see the world that way. And I think that's just who we are as human beings. This is requiring us to transcend that, and it's hard. And that's a deeply pessimistic view in a way that we'll never really get a lot of freedom because our brains just are suspicious of it. Having said that, we've done a lot. I mean, the world is much freer today than it was. The U.S. notwithstanding, maybe, but if you think about, we had the Soviet Union a generation ago. Now we don't. China, India, Israel, places with really serious problems on the economic freedom front, and very often in the political and civil freedom fronts. We are actually slowly but surely moving the world towards more freedom, notwithstanding the fact that our brains find that to be a very difficult thing to do. You're going to have to take two steps forward and a step back a lot, especially with politicians. But I don't blame politicians, really. I blame people, because politicians are reactors. They are not leaders. We look at them as leaders, but they're actually reflections of their populations, except in maybe crazy, you know, totalitarian places. But in democracies, it's mostly the values of the people that are driving the policies. The politicians are just implementing what they think the people want. If you're a leader in politics, in Democratic Party politics, you usually get unelected pretty quickly. So that's why I think, from my point of view as sort of an advocate for economic freedom, this is more valuable than me talking to the president or the prime minister. Because people like you, are the ones that influence them. Talking to them, they don't care about ideas. They care about getting elected. Again, lions eat zebras. It's what they do. So can't blame them for that. I saw one hand over here. Yes, sir.
Okay. At the beginning of the lecture, you showed one slide that showed on the one side Adam Smith and the next one Karl Marx.
Yeah.
I think this slide is maybe the most important slide in this whole show, because when you now advocate for the economists, for freedom economists, as a libertarian also, I think you're right, but I think you should get this, be much mature and look for criticism of the freedom economy, and look for its upside downs, but not only the upside, also the downside. Yeah. What we can understand from Karl Marx, and how we can cover in the inequality, we said earlier, and I came a little bit from philosophical background, and Hegel used to say that it's not that both of them are wrong, but maybe both of them are a little bit of right.
Yeah.
And how come you can, in the future, maybe this index can give you some criticism for economic growth and how to make it better for all of us can enjoy it?
That's actually the reason for the index. Yeah, thank you. I mean, that's the reason for the index. And I have published articles of myself in journals where I have, at the margin, been critical of economic freedom. There are some trade-offs in the world. One of the trade-offs is perhaps inequality. Although it's pretty flat, there are a couple papers where you might argue that against it. I can tell you, though, when you look at a lot of data like I do, there is very little that doesn't correlate. Causation is another argument, but at least correlate with, like these do. I'll give you the one example, and then I'll close. The only thing that I've been able to find when I do these charts, I can do it for malaria, HIV rates, you know, the World Development Indicator says 10,000 variables. You do it for any one of them. The only one that doesn't work is obesity rates. Blue countries are fatter than green, yellow, or red countries. American, we're like the leading example of that. So partly, and that's a problem, because obesity is a real problem. It's actually a health problem. Diabetes, heart disease, people, you know, it's expensive to the healthcare systems. I mean, it's a problem.
It doesn't benefit people that have more than they buy more meat.
So, but yeah.
The richer they buy more meat.
That's exactly what happens. They eat more. Rich people eat more.
It's not
unexpected.
But it's
true.
Poor people
are
buying a burger.
Yeah, cross-sectionally, we are.
Yeah, it's poor people. Buying a McDonald's meal is cheaper than going to a nice restaurant and getting it.
Right. Well, yeah. I mean, the point here is that's a potential trade-off. I mean, it's a potential trade-off that as countries get freer, they get richer, and one of the negatives of this system might be obesity. At least in a cross-country sense, that seems to be the case. Okay, we learned something. We now know something. Maybe we should work on that. I don't think we want to throw the baby out with the bathwater. I mean, I don't think you would then say, well, if rich people are fatter, we should just make people poor. No, that's kind of senseless, given that we know rich people are also healthier in every other way and everything else. I think that's a worthwhile thing. There's a whole bunch of people studying obesity as it's a growing problem, not only in the United States, but all around the world, and trying to figure out what the systemic issues are. That's a good thing to study. I would rather study it from the standpoint of data than the standpoint of ideology. And that's really the big lesson is, instead of arguing about it like the two people in the bottom, let's just slow down, run the numbers, and then we'll do what we're doing right now, argue about the numbers. If we're arguing about numbers, we are already we're in a better position than when we just argue from ideological bias, preconditions, which is what we usually do in life. So I think that's it. Thank you.